Still the original, still the best, now for more than 12 years. This is Radio Free Cybertron, hosted by Brian Kilby, with J.D. Church, John DeLuna, XV, Amy Morgan, Peter Van, and Rob Clay. For the latest Transformers news, visit tformers.com.
This is Radio Free Cybertron for Thursday, October 11th, 2012. It's 10-11-12. Are you excited? Hey, I'm Brian Kilby. With me, I have Rob Clay, XV, and John DeLuna. This is the post-New York Comic-Con Hasbro panel show thing. Apparently, there was news last night that, you know, look at XV.
Uh-huh. Things did happen last night.
Stuff happened.
Yes, that is fact.
Yeah,
that stuff. Is a fact.
So, so we have the stuff from the Hasbro panel last night. Actually, some interesting stuff happened. We'll talk about it later. We also have, this week, the TFormers.com news desk with JD and XV. We have the newest episode of the Rescue Bots review with Amy and Nicole, which is the episode Walk on the Wild Side. We have comic news and, most importantly, the new Transformers Rewind, which is Robots in Disguise, Attack from Outer Space. Aren't you excited?
Yay!
How's it been going this week, guys?
Good for me. How about you guys?
Decent.
My head hurts.
Max Steel.
It's too early for that, XV. Your head's going to hurt a lot more in about an hour.
Yes,
so
in about an hour, your head's going to be about the size of mine.
Yeah. Your brain's going to jump out.
Brian, my head could never be as big as yours.
This is true.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
It's that witty repartee that I miss so much when I'm not on the show.
Yeah.
It's the back and forth. The cerebral ping pong match that goes on.
And when you're not on the show, we miss having a personality.
It's like two sides of the brain, right? I guess. Huh? Yeah, maybe.
So, I'd mentioned getting Max Steel. I've been wanting this freaking thing since I was 7 because this old woman at church broke mine. She was evil. I think she's been exercised since. But got it $8 on eBay, best $8 I've ever spent. big thank you to Don for getting Thundercracker for me. Thank you, Don. Excited about that. Looking forward to opening that. I wasn't going to, but John assures me that it's pretty awesome, so...
It is. It's awesome. You'll be surprised. You'll be shocked, perhaps, maybe, just how much better a few changes, a few nips and tucks can make to a mold.
Yeah, I was never really crazy about the Starscream mold, but the pictures on the internet look quite a bit better. I wasn't going to get it because Starscream, you know, we've had a Starscream before, you know, so what? But the fact that, you know, Toys R Us has Thundercracker, not released, at least in that mold. Did we ever get a Thundercracker from Masterpiece? Was there...
Yeah, in Japan there was a Masterpiece Thundercracker.
Okay, but not.
But Japan hasn't gotten this mold as a Thundercracker yet.
Exactly. So that intrigued me enough to really sort of want it. Don said, "Hey, I've got an extra. Do you want it? Tax is cheaper where he is. So sure, it's fantastic. I should have. I was hoping to get Hinch for today's show, but it doesn't look like that is or didn't happen. I'll have that tomorrow. Been really excited about getting Hinch. I'm kind of curious. One. How big the toy is going to be compared to the previous stuff that I got from Iger. And just generally curious as to whether or not it's going to sort of scratch the same itch that, like, Rager did. I mean, I really, really liked Rager. It was a character that never really got a great toy. Of course, you know, not that Huffer needed a great toy. But a toy that maybe sort of fit the character a little better, you know, the little asshole that we all love so much.
I thought that was me.
Yeah, that's true. But I'm really curious. Bronze also a character that really his toy never really did much. That's really the case for most G1 characters, though, to be honest. I mean, honestly. I mean, some sort of maybe have character, I guess. Maybe Grimlock, maybe. in robot mode. I mean, vehicle mode, not robot mode. But, you know, Braun was, like, just one of the really more iconic G1 characters, especially, like, in the first season. And it'll be really interesting to see what the what that toy's like. And I don't think I will ever get Weapon Specialist, but if I really like it, I might be inclined to do that, because for the very same reason, Ironhide, great character, iconic G1 character, crappy toy. Crappy toys.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. So you have to review them on the show next week, if possible.
Yeah, I'll give my thoughts. I'm really looking forward to that. I don't know if I like it as much as Max Steel.
Well, I'm telling you.
Or GoBot binoculars.
But, that's right. It's like a nice fresh pot of meth. It's hard to top. Yeah, I've also got. Hopefully, I can give my thoughts on the show. Probably not next week. Maybe the week after that. But I did pre-order Photron, the Not Reflector. So maybe for our third party show, I'll be able to talk about him, because I have. I don't have much of an expectation going in, so we'll see how he turned out.
I strangely enough, the third party show is also our Halloween show, and our first show that we when we return back to Wednesdays for the live recording. So that will be kind of interesting. So if you watch the show live on October 31st, we will be moving back to Wednesdays. I'm very excited about that, because I get home much earlier on Wednesday than Thursday. So But the third party episode will be Halloween. Maybe, I don't know, we can figure a way to sort of theme that up. Rob Springer will be on via tape delay, and should be pretty awesome. He's going to have something crazy for us. I've challenged him to have something really terrible for Halloween. I'm excited.
This can only end badly.
I know. Isn't it great?
Yes. Be awesome.
Okay, let's go ahead and jump to the tformers.com news desk, where I don't even know what you guys talked about this week. I haven't watched it yet, so I'm just going to trust.
That's probably for the best.
I want to trust that there's no full frontal nudity in this. So for the podcast viewers,
I'm
spared.
I'm making no promises.
Yeah, it is JD. Oh God, wait, no. JD records this after superhero time,
yeah.
And he's wearing clothing, which debunks everything he's ever said about recording superhero time.
Well, no, because he makes a point to say at the end of recording superhero time that he's going to go put some clothes on to do the news desk, because we have to be on video.
Just keep that in mind, people watching this video. We'll be right back.
Tformers.com news desk, bringing you the highlights of the last week's news. I'm XV.
And I'm JD.
So, what do you think is the most highlight, Fort Max?
Yeah. Dude.
So, Encore Fortress Maximus is finally coming out. It's going to have the Master Sword, probably all its guns, all the stuff that Brave Maximus didn't come with 10 years ago or 12 years ago. Oh, I'm so old.
Oh, God.
So what do you think about this, JD?
What do I think? Like, okay, so here's JD. Like, the morning that this broke, I see the tweet from Big Bad Toy Store, or actually it was on Facebook. There was a picture on Facebook, and Benson Yee actually, like, instantly retweeted it as well, or remessaged it. And I'm like, holy crap. And I start messaging Jeremy Disbro, Anthrax Prozac for old school people. And he's like, no, dude, it's an April Fool's thing. I'm like, no, it is not. It's on Big Bad Toy Store. So I pre-ordered it within like the first 30 minutes that it was up. I've since actually changed my pre-order to, a different, place. Big Bad Toy Store is the first place that it broke. So I don't mind mentioning that, but I don't really want to get into a whole buyer war with it, but
you have pre-ordered one, and are you looking forward to that?
Oh yeah, I mean, obviously, yeah, I'm pretty excited. I had to actually pull myself back, because I ordered the drop ship one, and then it was like, you know, and Jeremy made the point too, it's like, you know, we've waited like 20 years for this. I think I can wait another month and save myself $50. So So I'm going to get the slow ship one, and, you know, so getting a good deal on it, getting free shipping, so I feel good about that. So.
Yeah, and for a lot of people, it'll be the first way to get, you know, a legitimate first-party Master Sword also.
Yes. Yeah, I'm excited about that. I'm actually going to cry, though, if in, like, another couple months they release the Grand Max version with the shell. And then I would, like, I would bawl my eyes out because there's no way I could buy both.
Right.
So I'm going to just hope that's
not. No, I mean, I'm thinking that's most likely going to be the eHobby version of this, or possibly Amazon Japan, because they're getting into the exclusive recolor outfit now.
Yeah. I would.
So, I mean, it is going to happen, and probably soon it's just going to be a matter of what avenues you have to go through to get hold of it.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it depends on whether that shell, you know, mold is still out there.
Well, the thing is, though, you know, and they've done this for other stuff, too, they can recast that from existing toys.
True.
If they really want to do this. You know, they can remake that. They did it for the Constructicons just recently.
Yeah, that's true. So, I don't know. I'm not going to worry about it too much. I think I'm going to be happy with the Fort Max and the sword. And I actually ordered the add-on set as well with, like, the posable heads and the little sword as well. So, yeah, I'm going all out. Yeah.
You what know. Does your wife think of all this, JD?
She's fine. Love you. So, yeah.
So, moving right along, Masterpiece 15 and 16 were announced as cassette packs for Soundwave.
And they look amazing. Just look at that. I mean, what's great is, like, they're even posed in, like, the poses from the box. And they're able to actually pose that way as opposed to, say, the original figures, which couldn't really do that.
Well, but, you know, considering that the box art pose was Ravage's most iconic appearance, being that almost every comic book appearance was traced off of that, it was probably very important to them that the toy would be able to replicate that.
Yeah, absolutely. And, yeah, and it looks great. I mean, obviously, you know, Rumble and Frenzy are the same, but the Ravage one, I mean, the Ravage looks really good, so.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, I'm going to laugh in a way because, I mean, do we not think that this is coming to the U.S.? I mean, is there any way this is not going to hit the U.S. market and come with all the cassettes?
I don't know about all the cassettes, but, you know, you'll at least get a couple of these.
I would imagine the U.S. set would at least come with Ravage and Rumble. But well, I wouldn't be...
Laserbeak's kind of like the one everyone remembers.
What was there was the U.S. reissue of original Soundwave. It came
right,
with...
It came with Laserbeak and Ravage.
Laserbeak and Ravage. That's
and
a likely
the,
set,
Comic-Con
too.
Comic-Con one came with those two, and I believe Buzzsaw and Rep additionally.
Yeah, so that's a likely, you know, that's a possibility as well. I'm definitely not getting the Japanese version of all this. I'm thinking what I'll probably do is get the American version if it comes out. To be honest, I'm kind of at a toss up between this and the Fall of Cybertron. You know, I'm going to be just as happy with Fall of Cybertron Soundwave.
Yeah.
I mean, because that's just got an awesome gimmick and everything else, so.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's going for two different things anyway, but the Ravage, I'm really interested in that Ravage, and if I could get that without the attached Rumble.
Yeah.
I'd be pretty happy to do that.
You don't want the pile drivers?
No. No, sure. Now look, I got the Transformers United Frenzy and Rumble little tank dudes that have their built-in pile drivers that actually transform from their arms. You know, I'm happy with those, but I don't have a nice Ravage yet.
Yeah, I do. I'm with you. I do want a nice Ravage. So I'm just gonna hope beyond hope that you know it comes out in the U.S. and is affordable and does this. You know.
And see, although, the great thing about these cassette packs is that you don't have to have Masterpiece Soundwave to use them, because the cassettes are the same size as the G1 cassettes.
So these cassette packs are going to be sold separately? Is that, I mean, that's what they're essentially...
Yeah,
how much are those going to be?
$50 to $60 each.
That's darn tempting.
Well, yeah, I mean, they're going to, of course, be smaller than the Scout-sized Frenzy and Rumble from before, but it's about the same pricing.
Right. That's really tempting. So it's, what is it, two packs then? Is that what it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, 15 is a two pack of Ravage and Rumble, and 16 is Frenzy and Buzzsaw.
Mm.
And tempting. Of course, Laserbeak comes with Soundwave.
Right. So you would get everything except like the second, what I would consider to be the second generation cassettes, which is like Rat Bat and Slugfest and.
I would assume Overkill. That Rat Bat would be the pack-in with Masterpiece Sound Blaster when that happens.
That's a good point. That's a good point.
Which makes me sad because Rat Bat would be the one I want the most.
Which means also the next set would be Overkill and Slugfest, which would be the...
Yeah, possibly.
Wow. Oh, man. It's like they know. It's like they know how to drain my wallet. It's like... They have found the magic formula for emptying my wallet. Offer them cassettes.
Speaking of draining your wallet, we got a picture of a couple new parts of Uranos.
I'm sorry, what?
The third party aerial bot team.
These are pictures of Uranus.
Uranos.
I'm sorry, Uranos.
So we have Blackbird based on Silverbolt and the little stealth bomber dude that turns into Superion's chestplate.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting but a fitting change to change him from the Concorde to the Blackbird. I mean, I think that's...
One obsolete aircraft to another.
Yes. I mean, at least the Blackbird makes sense in the context that... It's been used within the Mythos recently. So, yep. You know, it makes sense to use it instead of the Concorde, which the Concorde hasn't been around. I mean, does anyone beyond like our age even remember a Concorde? Like, I think the last time I even remember a Concorde referenced in popular culture was the Sabrina movie with Harrison Ford when he takes a Concorde from like the U.S. to France or whatever. But
yeah, that is entirely possible. I mean, the Concorde's been out for a while.
Yeah, so that's been gone. But there's a little stealth as well. I mean, this is basically just a gimmicky way to get the chess piece is all.
Without having to construct it into the figure.
Yeah, because they needed
the... Well, I mean, you know, with the original Superion, the chest plate was kind of an aircraft-ish thing.
Yeah. So,
I mean, it's a sort of logical progression, although, of course, you get now a sixth member of your aerial bots.
Is it sold separately, or is it going to come with...
I believe this comes with Blackbird.
Okay. Well, I'm okay with that.
It'll be more expensive than the other four pieces.
I think I'm okay with that, though. I mean, I would expect that piece to be bigger anyway. I mean, the nice thing is it doesn't... Seeing it compared with... who is it? The Firebolt? Fireshot? Firestorm? Fireflight?
Shot.
I don't know what it is.
Think.
I think it's Fireflight. Seeing it with Fireflight, I think it, you know, it looks... I mean, I'm not saying it's scale, but it's at least comparable in size. We'll put it that way.
See, this is why I don't like the aerial bots, because aside from Silverbolt, I can't tell a damn one of them apart from each other.
The only reason I think that's Firefly is because it's red. And I remember Slingshot. I know Slingshot. It's the other is...
Skydive?
Skydive, which is the black one.
And the other one is the one I can't remember its name.
Yep. Okay, so there you go. Aerial bots.
That's why we won't get aerial bots at retail in official capacity ever.
You know, it's like Kilby says. It's like that information was there at one point, and now it's been replaced with, like, marketing strategies and, like, you know, spreadsheet information, you know, work stuff. So it's like,
no, I don't think I ever knew all four aerial bot limbs or who they transformed into.
I don't know what, I mean, I don't know what the jets are. I mean, I can see them and know, but I don't know, you know, what they were specifically, other than the one that looks like the other seekers, like the Decepticons. Whichever right. one that is. We're awesome. Does it matter? No.
Keepers.com news desk this week. Now that we've made complete and utter fools of ourselves. Be sure to catch us next time.
Now time for Comic News with Amy Morgan.
Hello, this is Amy, aka Lady Rec, and I'm back once again with a Transformers Comics News and Reviews in 5 minutes. It's been a while since I've done one of these reviews, which I apologize for, but life happens, so... But let's get straight on to the important news bitsy stuff. First off, comic commentary is always up for review on the Transformers Facebook page. Whatever is current is up the week that it's released, so just check it out. It should be there. The Art of the Fall of Cybertron art book, yeah, that one that I kind of petitioned for, yeah, it's been pushed back from the beginning of October to the beginning of November, which is November 6th. So if you haven't pre-ordered that, you can still get on that bandwagon before it moves on without you. There were some digital comic issues for our international Transformers fans. This recently was resolved. But if you're still having a problem getting Transformers comics digitally, my suggestion is to politely contact IDW or Comixology or other app provider and let them know so that they can remedy the situation or give you tips on to getting their comics out so you can get them digitally. And that pretty much is the news for this week, so let's go straight into a review. So for review today, I have first props, and second, I'm gonna review it. So Robots in Disguise Annual, which was written by John Barber and drawn by Brendan Cahill, was also colored by Joanna LaFuente. And the flashback pages are by Guido Guidi. The story, basically, this two-issue annual wraps up the story that started in More Than Meets the Eye Annual. We met the Metro Titan, who in the end of that story space-bridged away. Well, he space-bridged to Cybertron, to the location of the city he once was in centuries ago, that are described in the flashback pages that Guido drew and colored. It picks up right where Bumblebee has sent Blur off to find Ironhide, only he finds the Metro Titan instead, and it's not safe. As Prowl and Wheeljack come to investigate, they find that the protons or whatever of the jump and the ones that are on the planet are not mixing well together, so, well, they've got a building explosion on their hands and a whole lot of people to save. Will they do it? And what happens when the Metro Titan wakes up? This issue also focuses on Metal Hawk as well, and I really loved where they went with it. So I was very impressed with Brendan Cahill's art this go-round. He's worked on, in the past, a half issue of Chaos Theory, all of Police Action last year, and Robots in Disguise issue number 7, which was just out this last July. And there have been a few little things here and there that I thought, it's okay, it's not great, it's not bad. There are little things to niggle at. But I can say that there wasn't really anything in this issue that caught my eye in a bad way. It was catching in my eye in a good way. I was like, oh my gosh, I like how I did that. Oh my gosh, I like how I did this. It was very solid. So compositionally, I was just really impressed with how he's arranging the comic, what he's putting into the panels. It just really worked for me. He's definitely coming into his own solid style here in Transformers comics, and I want to see him do more. So hopefully there are other people out there that enjoy it as well. So definitely pick this up. I enjoyed this issue so much that I gave it a 5 out of 5, and I highly recommend it. It was a very, very solid issue, and it's really great to see such a high standard in Transformers comics. For my second review, which is in no way a prediction to this comic's awesomeness, we've got More Than Meets the Eye, issue 9, also came out this month. Written by James Roberts and drawn by Alex Milne, colored by Josh Burcham. This is the beginning issue for Shadow Play, a 3-part arc. It basically is set up to be a totally epic story based on real events that definitely happened. Out of the words of Rewind, because he's the one that said them. He's got a group of the Lost Light characters hanging out at Swerve's bar. It's closed down and they're hanging out. They're telling a story of when all of their paths crossed for a brief time back in the day, in the hopes that this story will help wake Rung, who is still unconscious from the shooting accident. They have rebuilt his head, but he just hasn't woken up yet. So everybody gets a chance to take a turn to tell their part. And it's basically a murder mystery and political intrigue story, with a little bit of Orion Pax and a little bit of Prowl. But we learn things about some of the characters that we didn't know either, like Chrome Dome used to be named something else, and Drift. He was a drug addict before he met Gasket. So it's great to see Alex back on the More Than Meets the Eye issue. We didn't get him for the annual, and I sorely missed him. And it was just really great to see him back in this. It's like, yay! This is also a very solid issue. Everything really worked great for this issue of More Than Meets the Eye. Where the last few issues, like I said, the annual, there are a few things that just didn't work out. And then the Decepticon issues just weren't as strong as some of the other ones that James has written. So there are a few things in the past that have needed a little bit of polish, or other thing that kept it from making it a really smash hit. So this one really made it a complete package for me. And that's why it's another 5 out of 5 stars for me as well. The only thing wrong with it, I could say, is that I need the next 2 issues. I want to know what's going on and how this story is going to end. So yeah, I want all of the answers, and I want them now. both really solid issues this month. And that's my Transformers comics news and reviews. Thanks all for tuning in, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye. Routine patrols, fought bats and stasis. He's laid on a walk in the strangest of places. Earth was their home, now and in addition. Optimus Prime gave them this mission. Learn from the humans. We are back today with a mini retro review of Transformers Rescue Bots. I am Amy.
I am Nick. Hello.
Hello. And today's episode review reviews an episode. Oh my gosh.
Episode review of a review.
I said that. A review of an episode of episode review. Okay. Ugh. Train wreck aside, it is Walk on the Wild Side, which aired earlier this year on April 21st of 2012. It's Earth Day on the show this week. Well, at least in Griffin Rockland, the community is getting a new energy-efficient, environmentally-minded library, and the bots and the burns give the firehouse a spring cleaning. But the real guts of this show is just really kind of talking about pets. And when Cody leaves Boulder hanging on where to get a pet to go off to the zoo, the misunderstanding starts as Boulder thinks the zoo is the animal shelter where people go to adopt a pet.
Because they explained the whole pet thing and the shelter thing.
Yeah.
And of course, he's trying to think, well, this is more our size. So.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and that's pretty much what ends up happening. But mm-hmm. yeah, so the unfortunate thing is that the bots leave the cages unlocked so that in the morning we've got a town full of wild animals and the bots have work to do to get the animals caught. And the new library, yeah, it's so awesome that it's made out of trash, but yeah, it's literally attacked by trash sorting lemurs.
Those lemurs are so dang cute.
Yeah, they are. They are. And they're very smart. And yes, they start pulling everything apart. So,
oh no, including the mayor's hair.
Exactly. Which then he complains, you know, hey, they told me that this wasn't made out of plastic. That was great.
That was awesome part. That was so awesome. It was I like great. The idea that their whole library was recycled, though.
Yeah, yeah, and the books were also recycled paper. And I thought, wow, paper. That's mm-hmm. a lot of recycled paper there. That must have been a brand new, absolutely brand spanking new library to not have anything but recycled paper in there as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, it is the future.
It is. Sort of the future.
The near future.
It's a futuristic town. So, yeah. This is also the episode where Miss Niederlander begins to give them harassing calls to come save her cat. So, yeah.
Mr. Pettypaws.
Hmm? Yeah, Mr. Pettypaws. Darn you, Mr. Pettypaws. You should get a scratch board.
Doesn't she get the hint that cat's trying to run away from her?
Yeah. Who knows what she's doing to the cat in her house, putting like, you know, clothes or whatever on it. And it's like going, no, I don't
let
want those
go,
clothes.
Let me go.
Yeah. The cat. Oh, goodness. One of the other things I really liked about this episode is that once some of the animals get loose, like the cross-eyed lion, one of the kids, Cody, almost gets attacked until, Frankie shows up with a force field bracelet. I
awesome.
Want one. Yes, I want a force field
bracelet.
I was just
like, Wonder Woman, here we go.
Awesome.
Good stuff. Oh,
goodness. So, in the end, they use the lemur treats to catch lemurs, and then the lemurs become bait for the cross-eyed lion, and they were able to get them back into their cages. Yay!
I think it's important to say that no animals were harmed in the making of the show.
No. No animals were harmed, but some bots might have been stressed out.
Yep. But Boulder, this was his episode, and he was just so dang cute in it.
Yeah.
Especially when he gets his own little pit at the end.
Yeah. Yep.
Which is a very... I would probably kill this pet because I'm not good with plants.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's kind of like the moral of the story. The moral of the story is don't get a pet, get a plant.
But aww. See, I'm good with pets. I'm bad with plants.
Oh, plants are, they're pretty easy. All you have to do is just watch. When their leaves start going, then you know they need water. So
the thing is, I usually drown them. Aww. I overwater. Aww. I killed bamboo by overwatering it. You know how bad that is?
Oh, wow.
I know.
Wow.
I know. I'm goodness. Like one of the first people that I know that's ever done that.
That's very hard to do. You must have a talent for that. Oh, my gosh.
It's just like, because I heard it needed a lot of water, so I was watering tons. And yeah. I drowned bamboo.
Aww. For a minute there, I thought you said you drowned Bambi.
Yeah, that too. You know?
Oh,
I thought I'd change the ending a little bit.
Yeah, instead of Bambi's mom getting shot, we drown. We drown her. Yeah, yay. Go, go at the whatever.
He just going to be after me. No, yeah. I would never do that.
No. Yeah, yes, this is not really in real life. Like, we haven't really done anything to Bambi, so don't come after us. Oh. We're just running a fan podcast and all that stuff. So
exactly.
Yes. So, well, that is our review of this episode. We've got a longer review up over on the Rescue Center on the Underbase. If you're interested, you can check it out. And we'll catch you next week for the next review.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Aloha.
Just sitting there.
You're like the wacky waving inflatable arm inflatable tube man.
Ooh. Got to be careful about that inflatable thing. There are too many fanboys watching this.
Elbow rest. Why does Mike have that down perfectly?
Because he's really a female in disguise.
Oh, so he has his own high heels, huh?
Yes. He gives me tips all the time.
Mm. Oh, girlfriend. Uh-huh.
Cool. All right, cool. We are ready to go. Ready to rock and roll.
Rock and roll?
Party like a rock star.
I'm too old to rock and roll. More like rock and just stroll.
rock and stroll. Rock and stroll. Rock.
Just swing back. Yeah.
Awesome. Great.
This is Stevie Wonder. More Stevie Wonder.
We are the world.
There you go.
We are the children.
I think that song's about 25 years old now.
I know it is.
I remember when it came out. Maybe I need to get my lighters.
Radio Free Cybertron will return after these messages. Who will join me? Who will give up the power to transform, to become stronger, faster, more alive?
I will! Count me in!
And so, Action Masters are born. Transformer Action Masters are incredibly detailed action figures.
Action Masters! Action is alive, alive! Action Masters!
But the evil Decepticons steal the power and become Action Masters too. Led by Megatron and Starscream, they battle Optimus Prime, Jazz, and Bumblebee like you've never seen them battle before. Action Masters ride into battle in sleek transforming vehicles and fight alongside vicious transforming animals and battle droids.
Transforming! Action Masters!
Get in on the action!
Action Masters!
He devours entire worlds. His name is Unicron, and he's heading for Earth.
Fight him on your own side, Unicron!
Obviously, Optimus Prime, that would not be you.
Will he crush the Transformers in his evil grip? Or just blast them into oblivion?
The universe is mine!
Transformers. Each sold separately. Batteries not included. Actual change time will...
Radio Free Cybertron!
Stay with me!
I'm on you like glue!
Alright!
Hi guys, can I skate with you?
Nah, you're just a girl.
Powerglide!
Aren't you jumping to conclusions? Let her try. You might be surprised.
Okay, but...
Thanks!
Wow, look at that!
All right!
Remember, don't judge people till you give them a chance.
Now we know.
And knowing is half the battle.
The Transformers!
We now return to Radio Free Cybertron. Radio Free Cybertron.
Transformers.
Rewind.
This week on Transformers Rewind, it's Attack from Outer Space.
Now this is the life. It's like a zero-gravity tanny salon up here. No more final countdowns or booster tanks. That thing almost gave me a hernia. That's one big cloud.
NASA launches a space shuttle, but unknown to them, Muvor has replaced a normal space shuttle, which you'd think someone would notice given Muvor is only about the size of a large car. Muvor's mission is to track Autobot movements to find the location of their base, but the normal activities of the Autobots prove utterly ridiculous, and Muvor can determine no sane patterns from them.
2, 1, liftoff! We have liftoff! Houston, you're in control!
Roger, Kennedy, thank you. Headwinds nominal, low wind, no booster separation at 236.
That is sweet! What am I going to have to do before they let me become an astronaut?
You'll have to work really hard, Koji.
Work? Oh, man. Like starting today?
Starting whenever you want to be an astronaut.
All clear for rocket booster separation. And 45 till open.
Muvor eventually decides Sideburn is the best bet for finding the Autobot base, and sends the other Decepticons on a wild goose chase through places Sideburn has visited. The Autobots, somehow, catch on to what's happening, and use an unknowing Sideburn as bait for the Decepticons.
Speaking of slackers, where could Sideburn be?
Hold on, Ty.
But Optimus, what about Moovor?
I don't think Moovor is going to attack.
You're right. They seem to be using the shuttle to track all of the Autobots' paths.
True, but they haven't meant to ambush any of us yet. The Decepticons just might be after something greater. They may be using Moovor's ability to trace one of our paths back to here. In that case...
Of course. They know where our base was.
What?
What?
Transformers! Is that flying piece of tin still daydreaming?
I hear you loud and clear, Mega Octane. I may be in orbit, but I'm not deaf.
Wonderful. Listen, Moovor, have you made progress of any kind in finding the Autobot base?
I would've, if it hadn't been for a couple of furballs ditch-digging in the desert. I'm tracking Romeo on wheels now.
Good. Let's follow Sideburn.
You got it, Chief.
Aw, come on, Beautiful. Slow down just a little bit. You know I can't resist a shiny red sport model like you. Hey, I know a great little drive-in theater. It's romantic and it's very, very classy.
Please tell me it's not that blue sports car again. Oh, it is. It totally is.
Skeptical of Moovor's reliability, Scourge and the others head to Cybern's latest position, where they're quickly ambushed. The Autobots already have the upper hand, but the battle is decided as Moovor accidentally blasts Scourge from orbit. Repeatedly. The Decepticons retreat, as Decepticons are wont to do, and as the Autobots try to talk to Cybern about his sports car problem, an errant satellite knocks Moovor out of orbit to crash into the ocean below. Sad space shuttle.
Prepare to meet your manufacturer! Ready? Aim?
Sword of Fury!
Fire!
Goodbye, Optimus!
No, that didn't happen. It wasn't me, I swear!
So you see, we had to continue using you as the decoy.
But what about the red car promise? That was cruel and unusual.
Perhaps, but you never would have gone to the pier otherwise. And besides, your pursuit of that red car kept the Decepticons away from our true base.
Right, little man. Our secret base feels safe because you have a thing for red sports cars. Before, I've towed you away for this sort of thing, but today, you get the thumbs up.
So I'm going to go ahead and throw this to Mickey because I have this odd feeling he has some thoughts on this episode he'd like to share with us.
If Mickey, the whole episode had been that brief, I would have been much more okay with having to watch it. As I was talking to XP the other day about I was trying to sit through the episode, Robots in Disguise is like watching Digimon only starring Big Lots G1 knockoffs.
That's an apt description. I like that.
It is. I don't think it would be so Digimon if it wasn't Bang Zoom dubbing it, but...
The voice acting is terrible. The jokes are lame. The animation is...
Not.
Awkward. At best.
No, not animation.
I just love how many characters have got faceplates they don't have to even move to animate.
Why do you think I have this pop filter over my mouth? I
remember hearing a story once, I think it was about Beast Wars Neo, where in the beast modes, a lot of them would walk on two legs because the animators felt it was too difficult to animate them walking four-legged.
Oh, God.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, welcome to the world of, you know, end of last decade, last century, G1... Japanese Transformers cartoon.
Yeah, I just remember at the time I tried to watch Robots in Disguise. It was airing, and I could never make it through a full episode because I hated it.
I enjoyed it when it was on.
And as time has gone by, I've listened to people talk about how great Robots in Disguise was, and you know, Skybot's a great character, and Scourge is awesome. And so, okay, I'll give it another shot. And no, you people are retarded. This show's awful.
I do like Skybot, and that's about the extent of.
Skybite's the only one who really has staying power. Everybody else is kind of all over the place, much like Rob's camera. Rob, why don't you tell us what you thought about this episode?
Well, I thought that everybody in it was a complete and total idiot. I don't know what else to say. That was my thought watching this this afternoon. I mean, the same thought of this is terminally anime that I had watching the first episode, plus, wow, everyone here is really stupid. I mean, there are episodes of G1 where everyone involved is really stupid, but there's still something to pull you through it, hopefully. This, not so much.
I was hoping that Moovor would actually do something, but...
He did.
besides go to space?
He did. He fell down.
Yeah.
And he shot Scourge in the back.
Repeatedly.
Yeah. he's just floating in space like this. Yeah. That's basically all he did for the most part throughout the whole episode. That's the thing you have to expect. They're going to be stupid. Every character on this show is stupid. That's just basically one of the basic tenets of the show. If you get past that, it's kind of watchable.
One thing that's always struck me watching Robots in Disguise episodes, you know, I watched about half of Car Robots Raw when it was airing, and of course the video encoding back then was, you know, total shit.
320 by 240 I think was best that we got.
Generally, yeah. It just strikes me how much better the show looked in 320 by 240, all blocky and pixelated. And it does. Where you can actually see how awful it looks.
For example, right now, your Skype video on my end is about what Car Robots look like.
Yeah.
So people watching this on YouTube or on the show, what you see with XV on your screen, that's what we got back at tfextreme.com, wasn't it?
And you see, I do this as a courtesy for the viewers so they don't have to see what I actually look like.
You're not that ugly. I was surprised.
You just use your imagination to fill in the details of the episode.
Basically.
Yeah, I mean, Mickey and Kilby have had special opportunities to actually see me in, like, three dimensions. In full
It's
detail.
Like you were actually there.
It was weird.
I know. It's amazing.
So, XV, why did you pick this episode specifically? What was it?
Seriously, why?
Because this is one of a few episodes that have never aired in the United States.
Really?
Oh.
After September 11th, all the building destruction was considered, you know, unfriendly. So while this did air in Canada and I guess in the UK, which is where the DVD rips came from, the United States never had it.
Yeah, you're right. I don't remember seeing this airing in the US. I didn't realize that. Huh, okay.
So my final question to you before we wrap the segment up is, do you think anything of value was lost by not having this episode in the US rotation?
Nope.
No, not compared to Skybyte Saves the Day.
Yeah, that
well,
was...
Do I even really need to give an answer?
It'd be funnier if you did, but that's okay.
You can hear our show on Stitcher Smart Radio. Stitcher allows you to listen to your favorite shows directly from your iPhone, Android phone, BlackBerry, or Palm phones. On demand and on the go. Don't have Stitcher? Download it for free today at Stitcher.com or in the app stores. Stitcher Smart Radio, the smarter way to listen to radio.
We are back. Thanks, guys. Thoroughly enjoyed Rescue Bots this week, as well as Rewind and, of course, Comic News. Thank you. Thank you, Amy. Next week, I guess, on Rewind, we'll probably do SOS Dinobots.
Okay.
Yeah, we're excited about that. if you haven't gone back and watched previous episodes, last week we did Dark Awakening. Definitely worth watching. You can catch that on YouTube at youtube.com/TF Radio Network. And we also have a link on the show notes. I actually make a point to do that now. So
that's good.
Yes. So this week the big news is the coverage from San Diego Comic-Con. New York Comic-Con. I always want to say San Diego Comic-Con because that's the one people care about. New York Comic Con, at the Hasbro panel from last night. It was the Hasbro brand panel. I guess the biggest news was we got more photos of toys and a clip from Beast Hunters. You know, that's interesting, but it's just so much sort of random crap showed up. I kind of like just random crap. It's kind of like a hodgepodge of stuff. This will probably be the last big news cycle or news piece that we have, I would say, for the rest of the year, sadly. Until Toy Fair in February.
Yeah, this show is going to suck for the next 2.5 months.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, let's see here. I guess Beast Hunters, probably should mention that first. That's going to be the Season 3 arc for Transformers Prime. And basically, it's pretty much the most literal name possible. It's like beasts that are hunted, and they hunt. And it's in Transformers Prime. Congratulations. Let's see here. Let me pull up some photos.
I like the logo. I like the very He-Man-y logo.
Yeah.
It's very 80s. It's very, you know, like Saturday morning cartoon looking. I think that's probably what they were going for. Something completely different.
Probably. And thanks to TFW 2005, where we are lifting these photos from. They got some great photos yesterday. So, yeah.
Today.
It's today? This was last...
The panel was this afternoon.
Oh, it was the pre-party was last night. Ant was... Anthony from TFU.info had asked me if he wanted to come on, if I could have him on last night. I'm like, yeah, the show's tonight. So unfortunately not. But yeah, Beast Hunters, it's a very, very sort of 80s looking logo.
Somebody in the chat said it looks like the Gargoyles logo, which is totally true.
I can see that. Mm-hmm. I can see that. Part of me wanted to go Battle Beast, but that's probably just because of the name. It's pretty cool. The icon, the symbol though for I guess are they Predacons?
Yeah.
Let's see. I don't think I see a photo here. It's making the rounds on the internet. If you haven't seen it, it's okay. It's not bad. I really like the sort of classic, you know, Beast Wars style symbol for that. But it's not bad.
Yeah, it's a different It's just a different aesthetic. Like, it doesn't fit with the Predacon, the Maxible, and the Viacon logos from the past.
Yeah.
It's just different. It's very curvy.
Yeah, it is. So we got photos from toys that are coming up in the line. And one sort of interesting is Bulkhead. From he is the Beast Hunters Commander Wave 1 version. He has this weird sort of Viking helmet on.
A fashionable Viking helmet.
I like it. So I don't actually have the Voyager class Bulkhead. Is this a remold, or is this?
It's the Cyberverse one.
Oh, it's the Cyberverse one. Okay, because I knew it didn't exactly look the way I saw it before. So I guess they've remolded the head.
Yeah, they would have had to.
I'll probably be the one to comment on that because he's got the complete Cyberverse collection.
Yeah, just looking to get to the picture. Which one is it?
It's the slide number. Let's see here. It's
this is like a real boardroom meeting.
Yeah.
Ah, there it is. Like, yeah, that is.
Please
that
go
is
to
definitely
slide
a new
7.
Mold. That's. So yeah, definitely a new head.
New head mold, but the rest of the... Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other major differences there? Is the weapon the same?
Weapon is new, and so is the spikes on the front and the shoulders looks to me.
It looks really nice. I mean, I've got to admit, it looks really good. In fact, it's hard to tell. It's really easy to tell what scale the toy is or toy should be from photos. I actually kind of thought that this was, like the Voyager toy, because it looks really nice and detailed. I think I will definitely be buying this just because of the helmet.
Oh yeah, the helmet's great.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, you know, proportionally, I was not a huge fan of the Cyberverse Bulkhead. It just didn't quite match the show model, but I tend to be a little more forgiving with that with Cyberverse because it's Cyberverse. It's tiny. So.
Yeah. Let's see here. I'm looking over the stuff. Right now I'm looking at Beast Hunters Bumblebee, and I really just don't care. I'm going through. Here's Smokescreen. Arachnid. Oh, God.
Well, the Cyberverse one looks a lot better than the Deluxe one.
It would have to.
I really wanted Arachnid to transform into a spider.
That would have been nice.
That would have been better. She looks more like a spider. Twin Strike. That's kind of like Center Twin, really, isn't it? Same colors.
Yeah.
That's
basic. Yeah, I think that's the idea.
Go to that. If you're interested in looking locally, it's image 23 out of the slideshow. Yeah, he really, at least in Beast Mode, the gun, the placement, the colors, the head, that's 100% a Center Twin homage. Which I'm very fine with. In fact, if they want to like do a blot next, that would be pretty sweet. Or any of the poised from that line.
But, you know, mostly Blot.
I would kill to have a Blot. So, I guess... I mean, Hunger... Hunger, though, is basically just, in concept, too similar to Center Twin. Not the same, obviously, kind of animal, but the two-headed deal. Kind of, I guess it would be just a little too derivative if they went there, but... I really do like Hunger. Even in, especially, he has like the most generic G1 robot mode ever. At least for like the Scramble City. Which is kind of hard to even imagine. But I still like that toy. Going through here again, there's some other toys that we're getting that are a little bit interesting. Predaking is coming out, and Predaking is. Is that a Cyberverse or is that a Voyager? That's a Voyager, isn't it?
There's both.
Ah, so this is the... Okay, this is definitely the Cyberverse. Let me get back to the Cyberverse version. It's nice looking. It, for some reason, gives me sort of... oh, what was it? Was it Scourge? Was that the name?
The dog?
Yeah, no...
Or... No, Rick, it's not that.
No.
I know what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about.
Cybertron?
It's the color scheme.
Yes, that's exactly what it is. Yeah, it was Bruticus. It was Bruticus, though, wasn't it? He was a three-headed dog from Robots in Disguise, or was it Armada?
Robots Rid. In Disguise, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, just it's the color scheme. That's all that it is. That's what does that. It's okay looking. Let me go back to the Voyager. That's earlier in the slideshow. I think.
I mean, the stuff that they're doing with like the regular characters is kind of interesting. It reminds me of like the mutated spiky kind of power ups that you would see in the 80s. You know, that you would give characters where they become spiky and monstrous and that kind of thing. It's not something you would expect from Transformers, so it's interesting. It's an interesting take. Beyond doing just like recolors and throwing on a couple extra blasters and releasing the toy like that, it's, you know, I hope it does well. It's an interesting twist on some old ideas.
Yeah, Beast Hunter's Deluxe Bumblebee is pretty hideous. Pretty hideous.
Yeah, and you wouldn't expect that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's just kind of like he's a bunch of spikes. Just a ball of spikes.
Yeah, Wheeljack doesn't do anything for me either. Like, they added... Are they tendrils? The things on his arm and on the door of the car? Kind of looks like whiskers or something. Just, it doesn't really necessarily... Doesn't do anything for me. Let's see here. I'm going to skip ahead past the Beast Hunter stuff. Oh, Laserback. Now that one's interesting. Let me pull that up.
That's because it's a new mold.
Yes, but it's not only is it a new mold, it's very interesting looking. Let's see if I get a better angle on it.
Yeah, he's very, I don't know, Beast Machines-y.
Beast Machines-y or maybe even Transmetal 2-y sort of.
Yeah.
So something kind of from that era. It's nice looking. It's not bad at all. He's a griffin, I guess. Is that what he is?
Sure.
It's something.
Yeah, it's definitely definitely something.
Yes.
It's something with four legs.
Okay.
And he stands up on two of them, and he's a robot.
Yes.
How about that?
Here is the... let's see if I can get this up here a little better. The Voyager version of Predaking. There we go. It's definitely not bad looking. I don't know that it's... It seems to me, at least from the pictures and like the buzz from this, this seems to be like the most prominent toy or the new toy from the line. And I think that's mostly the cause of the reuse of the Predaking name. But
it's going to be a faction leader.
Ah, that makes sense. But the thing is, I like it. Okay, I guess it looks okay. It's certainly more interesting than most of the vehicle-based stuff that we got, but it's not, like, super exciting. Like, back back when the Unicron trilogy, you know, was coming out, we would get photos of like Cybertron, Megatron. You know, it something is like, you know, he was a faction leader. It was something new, something big, and it's kind of exciting. Even in retrospect, if it wasn't that great, like Energon Optimus was kind of hideous, but the photos were still kind of exciting because it was so radically different. This seems less new and more just like a callback to like stuff scattered between like Transmetal to Beast Machines and then through Cybertron. Just doesn't seem to like do anything new.
I agree. It's like seeing Jim Ross on TV. It's hideous, but also kind of exciting. Yes. I would agree with that. You know what? The thing about Pretty King is like he's totally getting all this hype. You're right, because of his name, his color scheme, and that's about it. Because otherwise, he's Thundertron. So, you know. He is in the trailer now. He is in the trailer teasing Beast Hunters on the show. So I hope he lasts longer than Unicron. I hope he's a little bit more impactful than Unicron, but
Unicron was awful.
No guarantees with that show.
So are we? I'm assuming that the character redesigns for the Autobots probably won't carry over to the show. Really, they're just adding some flourishes, so it's entirely possible that they could. So I really want to see that helmet on Bulkhead.
Yeah, I don't think it's out of the question. I think they have to do this to some degree on the show, right? I mean, they have to. The idea is to sell the toys. I would think that's still one of the goals.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like in Beast Wars.
Sure about that?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's why I said. You know, I think I know their business plan,
It wasn't to begin with. I mean, there wasn't even a toy line to support the series, which was apparently by design.
Yeah,
that was not a good design.
No.
Yeah.
But it's not like with Beast Wars when there was like a drastic, like when they went from the original toys to the characters that became Transmetal. It's not like there was a huge, it's not like that, which was a huge change. You know, they had to invest in new 3D models and such. It looks like they're just tacking stuff on. I want the frickin' helmet. Okay.
You going to just like troll eBay for the helmet?
It looks like
maybe able to score the helmet for like $5 maybe from Taiwan or something. I don't know. Maybe a factory worker will just sell a bucket of helmets to the world.
That's entirely possible, actually.
They would buy it, by which I mean you would buy it. You would buy a bucket of the helmets.
So let's move on to something important. Creo. So we got, now that photo's a little too tight. They have their 2013 product rollout. I don't really know what to make of some of it. The first slide is Ripclaw. And I guess that's a kit that's going to come out that comes with a mini little Ripclaw figure and a human, a human enemy. But that's kind of an interesting looking kit. Is it based on another kit? Because, I mean, there has to be some sort of cannibalization in this line. I mean, basically it's like Lego. They just basically come up with about 400 different parts and reuse them over and over again. So is this kind of like a cross between something else? The legs look like it. The legs and arms basically look like they came from Vortex. But he has a tail and wings.
Which would be the new parts for this kid, I guess.
I mean, it looks nice. I mean, I like it. And I love the look of the Creon. I really love the look of that Creon. So I don't know that so far, Vortex is the only Creo, like, major Creo kit that I've picked up for the Creo kit itself. But this one looks really nice. I would consider this one. Let's see here. I do like Creo way too much. Let's see. What else do we have? Oh, God, another Bumblebee that comes with a battle net. Yeah, so
it's a different type of Bumblebee. He's kind of reimagined, isn't he? He's a Jeep.
Yeah. So we have some photos of actual Creons here. Is that a Rector? Who is that? That is a trail cutter. Sorry. Versus Grimwing. That's actually really nice looking. So that's going to be a Creon that basically comes with a very small minor Creo kit, which I like those. This should probably be cheap. This is probably $5. I'm guessing, based on what it looks like it includes. I would love that price point if that's roughly what that is.
I definitely think the smaller and cheaper the better with the Creo stuff, you know?
Holy crap. I'm looking at this new because I didn't have a chance to look at this at work today. Holy crap, it's Windcharger versus Corrada. That makes me all kinds of happy. Corrada looks like crap, but who cares? It's a freaking snake.
It's a freaking snake.
I love that. I didn't get a chance to. I was so busy at work today, I didn't get a chance to look this over. So I'm pretty much hitting this raw. I love that, and the fact that they're actually using like a Beast Wars Neo character, even though in this case it's a very simple toy. It's really cool. It's not as cool as like when we got Long Rack. I guess Long Rack was what from Energon, but still pretty cool. Very cool. I like that. Any thoughts on that one? Or am I like completely alone in the dark on that? On liking that one so much?
I think you are, dude. I think you're the Creo guy, but bless you for being the Creo guy.
I mean, I don't buy that many of them. I love.
Who does?
Yeah, that's true. That's the problem.
Feel bad.
Like I mentioned before, when I got Vortex, Region Rotor, Rotor Region, or Rotor Rampage kit.
Rotor Rumble.
Yeah, I got it for $15 because I got it half price at a buy one, get one free at Toys R Us. So I've yet to pay more than full price. I mean, I've never paid full price for a kit except for the original Bumblebee that I got. Otherwise, every other kit that I've got, it was either free, on clearance, or half price. That's not a good business model.
No, it's really not a good sign when people are looking at your choice and going, boy, when that hits Ross, I am going to be happy to get that.
Yeah, I mean, like at BotCon, Hasbro was giving away the kits. And I'm like, I guess I got Jazz. I think it was Jazz. I don't want Jazz, but I'll take it for free.
I didn't even get one of those free Creo kits at BotCon.
Yeah.
It wasn't worth the trouble to stand there and wait for it.
So this is one of the more interesting items from the whole affair. It's the Platinum Edition Asian exclusive Omega Supreme, which XV enlightened me before the show. It'll be an Amazon and Big Bad Toy Store exclusive. That is, it's definitely a new hand. It's a new head. And, of course, it looks like it has gold paint apps. That's really interesting. It depends on the price. I probably won't get it. But if it's less than $100, I would consider
it. I think it will be less than $100.
You think so?
You think so?
Well, it is only a Supreme toy, so, probably 50 or 60.
Retail on the Supreme, though, was like $50 when they came out like 8 years ago.
No, it wasn't. 40.
How much were the what about the 2010 Unicron and Primus? How much were they?
No, Supremes were 50 because this is the same size class Unicron was in.
Yeah. So what was Unicron when it came out on Amazon?
60.
It was like 70, wasn't it?
70.
Yeah. Oh, that's probably a good mark.
Unicron would be a much more desirable character. Just because of sort of what he means. And not that Omega Supreme isn't sort of a popular character from G1, but I just don't think that he has the same sort of mystique going that Unicron did. And the fact that there was that highly desirable 2010 Takara version really sort of helped stoke desire for that toy. I don't know that this one will sell out quite as quickly. I may be totally wrong. I think I would pay 60 or 70 for it, if Kim would let me.
I think, I think you're probably right, but I also wouldn't be shocked at all to see it come out for 80 and in a much higher quantity than Unicron did, because they would just, like the Amazon.com buyer would be like, well, I blew out of these things like 2 years ago or a year ago for this. I'm going to up the price and up the quantity and see what happens. Yeah, roll the dice.
Not that I'm looking, but a friend of mine at work was telling me about how her best friend is a buyer for Amazon. She's like, if you're ever interested in moving to Seattle and working for Amazon, let me know. And I'm like, I would totally be the toy buyer for Amazon. That would be sweet. It'd be awesome.
It would be sorry for all of us. You just troll us.
Yes.
You have to think, too, though, you know, there's the G2 Bruticus set, which they're selling for less than the combined retail cost of the five figures.
It's pretty amazing, yes.
That's true.
It's possible. Good thought. So what makes no sense to me whatsoever is Energon Optimus Prime.
Oh, that makes perfect sense. It combines with Omega Supreme.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's in vaguely G1 colors.
And it's still
also is Omega Supreme.
And Omega Supreme is vaguely G1, but Energon Optimus Prime has never been a popular toy amongst anyone.
No.
I like it.
I like the combined mode, but everything else is kind of bad.
I mean, so like Armada Optimus still has a spot in most people's hearts. Most people still kind of like Cybertron Optimus. Energon Optimus is almost universally hated. I don't get this. Maybe I just don't really get it. Even if it does combine with Mega Supreme, it just makes no sense to me.
Maybe they couldn't get one without the other.
Yeah.
Could be.
Yeah.
No, these were Hasbro Asia initiated, so maybe they had to do both of them or not get either.
Yeah, in Asia, maybe they, you know, are considered, you know, much nicer toys. The box is kind of nice. Here's the one for Mega Supreme. But I
hope they actually update that package art before
it's
that,
instead of using the original art. Will. Yeah, which yeah. is I hope they don't. I hope they leave it in that art, honestly. It's the Year of the Snake edition. God, I can't believe
it. I hope they put G1 Omega Supreme on the box. Oh, that would be awesome. Shot of the toy. That'd be awesome.
Let's see. No. A scan of the instructions.
Oh, yeah, the line art. That would be great. and they're like, we don't know why this doesn't sell when we put the picture of the packaging up. It's thought that would only help.
Seems like the new head on Omega Supreme seems a bit smaller than the original. Yeah. I don't remember it looking quite that disproportionate.
This head's probably not a mini-con.
It should be.
It should be. Probably
yeah, it
not.
Should be. Really should.
I may be wrong.
Should be somebody. Should be, I don't know, Carly or some random G1 person, you know?
I could see Spark that, Plug. Oh, God. They could finally explain what happened to Spark Plug. did official non Dreamwave fiction ever explain what happened to Sparkplug?
No.
Not that it matters. It could be Chip Chase.
Did he just disappear or what?
I just assumed that he had a heart attack. He did. It was the 80s. Medical technology isn't where it is today, and he was in really bad shape. So
yeah,
if he's like my Uncle Ted, he probably died.
God. Well, you know, I'm sure he probably died of a heart attack as he looked up and saw some heavy thing falling toward him.
That's possible.
Yeah, I was going to say, he had a pretty stressful life after the trip showed up. Wasn't the greatest.
And, you know, he had already had one heart attack in the comics, so after that first one, it's always more likely.
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm. Anything else really worth talking about? So, they also showed off, I guess, a card game that's coming out. There's some photos from promo photos from the next IDW story arc, which is Rage of the Dinobots. I mean, yay.
Grimlock, awesome.
I mean I like the Dinobots as much as the next guy, but I don't care.
Well, about the only thing about Dinobots thing that was interesting to me is that it said, you know, after the fall, before the hunt. So that does kind of imply that there is already a planned, you know, follow-up of some sort to Fall of Cybertron to me. I would hope so, anyway.
Yeah, I mean, that would be pretty cool.
Yeah, well, this comic was explained to be to bridge Season 2 and Season 3 together and try to tie in some of the other fiction.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
So it's officially Season 3 prequel.
Okay.
All right. Hooray for aligned continuity.
Yeah.
It's probably trying to also set up hinting for Dinobot toys.
Hmm.
Yeah. So, are we getting anything other than Grimlock?
Not that we know of yet, but, you know, it occurs to me if they're going to do, you know, beast form Transformers in Prime, they would be very silly not to do some kind of Dinobots in there.
Yeah, but that's true.
They kind of done this before with Generations, where they snuck half the lineup into a separate branding to make the stores carry all of it at once.
Good point.
So, yeah. You know, put a couple of Dinobots in Prime, put a couple of them in Generations, and you have the same situation going again.
Mm-hmm.
Just make the styles vaguely compatible, and it'll all work out.
Speaking of, so when are we going to see all these Generations toys?
You missed them there last week. They all showed up, and they're all gone now.
Oh, my mistake.
Sorry.
Because it's kind of coming up on Halloween. We're kind of running out of 2012, and promised something.
The first wave of the 2013 Deluxe is supposed to ship from retailers next month.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Probably means that the Wrecker recolors of the Combaticons will be around February.
Oh.
If even that late.
Oh, boy.
You know, I'm starting to think. So, back at Toy Fair, that's when we first found out, correct me if I'm wrong, that we're going to get 40 or 50 new Generations toys for 2013. And, We've already seen, you know, quite a few. Unless they're ready to ship later on, early, you know, like mid 2013. Like the stuff, if it's going to be revealed at BotCon, more than likely will be showing up late in 2013 or 2014. If we don't see it until then, I mean, it's like
I think 2015. I think you were right the first time. 2015 sounds about right.
At the panel at the New York Comic Con today, they said that 2014 would very likely be a big Generations push for the 30th anniversary.
Oh, it'll happen. Okay. No surprise there. I mean, unless you know, they have some sort of huge slump, which is possible.
Well, it's possible. Will be a movie year.
Yeah. I don't know.
That's a slump waiting to happen.
So, oh man. It doesn't look like we're going to get Rumble and Frenzy from United. We haven't heard a thing about that. People just assumed that would happen, but we've not seen a thing on it.
They assumed that would happen. There was still a scout price point in some form or another.
Yeah, and they wouldn't sell those in the package together, I don't guess.
Apparently not.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they would have to sell them in a Voyager box, and this isn't Japan, so I don't think that would work too well.
Yeah. It's a shame. I wanted to get those at a reasonable price.
You know, the only chance for that early is BotCon now. Which still shoots down your reasonable price thing, but, you know.
Yeah, unless it somehow winds up being, I don't know, one of the Transformers Club exclusives, like one of the freebie toys, which is a good deal. I mean, it's included in your subscription. You know, I really, especially the one coming up this coming year, I'm really excited about. I thoroughly enjoy that. And most of those toys, if they were selling them individually, they would charge about what the actual subscription goes for. So, 2013, 2014, be interesting what we actually get in Generations, I guess. I fear that it'll be a lot of retread from the Fall of Cybertron stuff that's coming out. Maybe we'll get a third paint job on that Soundwave mold.
Well,
we will. It's going to be Blaster.
Are you counting Blaster?
Oh, crap. There's a remold there. But there's a remold there. Is a new head? Isn't there a new head with that?
Yeah, it gets a new head.
A new head and chest, I think.
I'll live with that. But I was.
Yeah, that's a legit blaster.
Yeah, I was even thinking that we might get like a shattered, almost like a shattered glass version. It's like, can't get enough shattered glass sound wave. Here you go. Here's a third one.
Man, you know that's coming.
No, I doubt it. I doubt it.
What?
I don't see it happening. It's the price point of the toy. I mean,
I'm talking about like as a club collector toy or something like that. They're going to do a.
I don't see it. I just
shattered glass fall of Cybertron.
The cost. The cost of that mold. I just don't see it happening. Maybe I'm wrong, but.
Okay. I hope you're right. I hope I'm wrong. There's no underestimating their love of shattered glass. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
They love them some shattered glass.
Maybe a mass retail release of Shattered Glass Ravage.
Sure.
Nah, I guess not.
Probably not. The BotCon, we haven't even talked about that. Or I guess maybe in the news desk they talked about it, but the little teasers have started for BotCon. So that's fun.
No, yeah. We didn't talk about that.
Oh, you did? Oh, I just assumed you would. Well, crap, I would have mentioned that earlier on. Yeah, oh. So BotCon has, FunPub has started teasing information about BotCon. I don't guess we'll find out the location, but, you know, as of recent, we've been finding out what the theme of the box set is, and there's a cadence of, you know, new information. When did we find out, like, what the set was going to be last year? I mean, it was long before the convention. It was several months. Was it? It wasn't 2011, was it, though? We didn't find out that early.
I know we find out. We usually, if memory serves, we learn about the location of the event in like December, January, and then I think the theme of the toys comes around the same time, if not a little bit before or after people start making reservations and stuff, I believe. So late this year, maybe probably after Christmas, we may start seeing stuff, a mold here or there, but not anytime soon.
Before we wrap up and sort of move off of this, any just guesses, because everyone has a guess, everyone has an opinion, where BotCon might be in 2013?
I'm going to guess the Midwest. I'm going to guess like Chicago.
That's FunPub. Cuz
it's the year before movie, so.
And FunPub hasn't done a show in Chicago that I'm aware of, have they?
I don't think so.
Not bad. I like Chicago. I'd be willing to go back.
Yeah, Chicago's fun. The BotCon that was there with the TFCC or whatever.
03 and 04.
Yeah, it was nice. It was fine. Yeah. You know, good pizza, good folks, that kind of thing. Nothing wrong. Yeah. Nothing wrong with that. So on the outskirts of Chicago. It wasn't in Chicago, but that's fine.
I have my heart set on Atlanta again, and according to Brian Savage, it didn't seem like completely out of the picture like I thought that it might be. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That would be cool. Atlanta's a great town. That's a good-sized town for that convention, too.
Yeah.
You know, it's not huge. It's a major city, so there's lots to do there, too. So that'd be fun.
Yeah, I would love that. It's not too far away that I couldn't drive. Lots of people there. I think it would be great.
Yes, it is also personally convenient to Brian Kilby. So we have
six hours away, five, six hours away, depending on if I'm driving from home or work. I want BotCon.
Any BotCon you make, sir, is good for BotCon.
Yeah, so. I love BotCon. Hopefully I'll be able to make 2013. Definitely be making Shardacon, and looking forward to SavCon 2014. Definitely should have some sort of involvement there. Actually, we should actually have a panel at Shardacon. We're still sort of hammering out details there, but that'll be exciting. I'm really looking forward to that. Hopefully, John, you should be able to make it. That would be really
awesome. When is it?
August 2013, I think.
Oh, yeah, sure. I'll make it.
Yeah, Shardacon.com. I'm figuring it'll probably just be you, me, and Rob Springer. Hooper X will probably be there, so we'll probably have him involved as well, since he hasn't been on the show in forever. And XV will not actually make the trip, so. Yeah, August 9th through 11th, Charlotte, North Carolina. So, pretty sweet. Excited. Really excited, actually, so. Okay, I guess that will do it for this week. Join the chat. We have a very active and vibrant chat these days. We have some people that are very dedicated. Doesn't look like Diecast showed up this week, though. So we got to figure out what's going on there. It's good seeing Skelfate.
Something must have happened to him for him not to be here.
It's good seeing Skullface in the chat. Skullface has been in the chat the last few weeks, and we haven't seen Skullface in the chat regularly in a while, so that's pretty awesome. But, you know, we record live starting on Halloween on Wednesdays at 8:30 Eastern time. We normally start streaming 8:15, but starting Halloween, it'll be on Wednesdays. If you want to join us between now and Halloween, it'll be on Thursdays. So, and thank you again, Skullface. So we really enjoy the chat, especially during the show. We'll look at it, but before the show, we're really sort of involved in sort of a, you know, back and forth with the people. And you know, if sometimes just works out that I get Thundercrackers by talking to the chat. Thanks again, Don. You're awesome. Hey, you know, I got to give Don props. Don's awesome. So, yeah, I guess that'll do it for the show this week. Follow us on Twitter at TF Radio, Facebook, facebook.com/TF Radio, and XV at your mom _loves house. Yes. Actually, XV doesn't actually exist. He's an illusion.
I'm very sophisticated.
Yeah, actually, seriously, though, at tfradio.net, we actually link to everyone's Twitter. So XV has a Twitter account, and you don't have to remember it. Just go to tfradio.net. It's on the right side of the screen. Just scroll down a bit. It's right there. So that'll do it this week. We will be back next week. Hopefully, next week, John will be back. XV will be back, Rob Clay, and I. So for the guys, Brian Kilby signing off. We'll be back next week. Have a good one.
This has been Radio Free Cybertron. Visit us at tfradio.net for show notes and to subscribe to the podcast. Follow us on Twitter at TF Radio for news and updates. Watch our live stream at tfradio.net/live. Join our Facebook fan page at facebook.com/TF Radio. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, TF Radio Network. Have a question or comment? Leave it on our Facebook fan page or mail it to contact@tfradio.net. Copyright 2012 TF Radio Network.